And we have our neighborhood block party that's going to be here September 9th. And so there's just lots of great things happening. So if you'd like to help us out and volunteer a little bit, get in touch with me or the church office, and we'll get you on the list, all right? A couple of things. Remember, we started at the start of the summer, if you were here. You remember the whole tacos for Jesus thing, all right? That was kind of a summer-long initiative. We were asking people, it doesn't have to be tacos, but if the Lord leads you to take some food down to the homeless camp down there at the other side of the tracks there, please do that. Just pray about that and see what God would have you do, all right? Just wanted to remind you about that's still ongoing. As part of our summer ministries, all right? A couple other things. I would ask you to be in prayer this week, especially for myself and for Pam. We are heading down to Florida, not for vacation, all right? We're not going to go to Walt Disney World or anything. We're heading down there for General Conference, which is our Free Methodist gathering. It happens every 4 years, and it's going to be a gathering of Free Methodists from all over our country and indeed from around the world for a week-long time of worship and of business and of decisions being made that will affect the future of our denomination. And so please be in prayer for that. I'm excited to be a part of such a great group of people as Free Methodists, and excited to get to have a part in some of the decision-making roles. So please be in prayer for me and Pam as we travel down there. I will not be in the office this week, obviously, because we'll be in Florida, just so you know that as well. But I do want to let you know that we have coverage in the office, though, and because we have a brand new secretary here, and I think, is Caitlin here? Are you here? Caitlin is right there. Caitlin, I'm sorry. I'm going to put you on the spot. I'm going to have you stand so everybody can see you, all right? This is Caitlin Donner, all right? And many of you know her, and she's been around for a very long, well, not a very long time, but a long time. All right. And so Caitlin is taking over our office duties from Pam. She is in training right now. You can go and sit down, Caitlin. It's all right. All right, yeah. And she's in training right now, and will be in training for several weeks yet to come. But so she's going to kind of be covering things in the office while we're gone. So if you call in and you get an unfamiliar voice, well, it's not really unfamiliar. It's just Caitlin, all right? So please be praying for her as she delves into this new role and position. And we're excited to have her on board and so much looking forward to it. And I want to let you know something. I went to the office today and I saw something. And I said to Caitlin, I said, I know God has called you here because on the desk, she had brought a Dr. Pepper.
Oh, no.
She likes Dr. Pepper.
What?
Amen.
No.
Travis, don't go there, Travis. All right. Anyway, yeah, I knew she was the one. All right. So please be praying for her, and thank you so much for all your help with that. All right. Okay. I believe that's all I've got to share with you this morning. So would you stand together and let's have a word of prayer as we begin our worship time this morning. Heavenly Father and our God, we love you. We thank you so much that you are here with us. Lord, I'm excited about what you're going to do in this service, and I just pray your blessing on it all now. As we come to worship you, may we lift our voices, may we lift our hands, may we just enjoy and glory in your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Oh, Lord. Oh, water, you turned into wine. You opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. Oh, there's none like you. And into the darkness you shine. Oh, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Lord, there's none like you. Our God, oh, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
water.
Oh, water, you turned into wine. Yes, you did. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, oh Lord. There's none like you, our God. Oh, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. You're awesome in power, our God. Our God, our God. Oh, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, let's do verse 2. Oh, into the darkness you shine, open arches we rise, there's no one like you, no, there's none like you, you're greater, Lord, oh. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And with our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Oh, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. Yes, Lord, we come to worship you today, O God, our healer. You're stronger, God. You're greater. You're greater than all that there is, O Lord. We praise you and worship you. Lord, we see your Bible says that there's these eternal things, Lord, faith, hope, and love. And that's, God, what we pray that you'll fill us with today, Lord. Fill us with faith. Lord, we know that it'll lead to hope and hopeful lives. And God, above all, let all those things lead us to love. O Lord, we know those are the things that will last forever. We praise you, Lord. We say that you are full of light, Lord. You are the light. We thank you, God. From the highest throne. From the highest throne to the earth below, you lay down your life for the likes of us. Oh, great is the love of the Savior. From a wounded heart to a life made whole, every human heart will declare as one, great is the love of the Savior. Lord of endless light, oh, let your glory shine forever. All the earth will sing your praise. The mountain. From the mountain heights to the valleys low, all created things given light to show. Jesus, we live for your glory. Oh, Lord of endless light, oh, let your glory shine forever. All the earth will sing your praise. From the rising sun, from the rising sun to the still of night, every waking moment for your delight. Oh, Jesus, we live for your glory. You are the Lord of endless light. Oh, let your glory shine forever. and sing his praise. Oh, the hope of every heart, and let your name be lifted higher. All our hearts will sing your praise. Be exalted, oh God. Oh, God, be exalted. God, be exalted in everything. We will live for your glory. We'll live for your glory. Yes, Lord. Oh, God, be exalted. God, be exalted in everything. We live for your glory. Live for your glory. Oh, Lord of endless light, oh, let your glory shine forever. All the earth, yes, all the earth will sing your praise. You are, Lord, the hope of every heart, and let your name be lifted higher. All our hearts, all our hearts will sing your praise. Yes, Lord, ever and ever, O Lord, your praise, may it ever be upon our lips, O God. O light of the world, you came down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see the beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Oh, here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh, so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all full of sin became poor. Oh, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Lord, we'll never know, oh Lord. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. Lord, I'll never know how much it cost, oh, to see my sin upon that cross. Lord, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Lord, you are altogether Wonderful, Lord Jesus. You may be seated. So we love to pray, don't we? Amen. So now let's come and pray. Let's pray at the altar and worship Him. Give Him our thanksgivings. Cast every care upon Him, the Bible says, for He cares for you. So there's nothing that God can't do. There's no question He can't answer. Amen. There's nothing He can't do. Don't think that this is too big for God this morning or too big for you. If we turn to Him, if we seek Him, the Bible says He'll let us find Him. So let's come and seek Him in prayer. So come to the altar. We'll sing this again, and as we sing the chorus, please come and pray. Don't hesitate. Oh, here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that You're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Light of the world, You step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore You. Hope of a life spent with
our Heavenly Father and our God, You are here this morning, Lord. And we give You praise and honor and glory, God. You are our all in all. You are our Master, our Savior, our Lord, and our friend. God, I thank You so much for the way You're moving in each of our lives, the way You're moving in our church, the way You're working in our community, God, and in our world. Lord, there is darkness out there, that is for sure. But Your light still shines through. And God, we thank You that You are Lord of all. This morning, Father, we come to You. And we lift up those who are hurting, those who are struggling, maybe, God. Pray for all those who need a special touch from You. Lord, You know each life, and You know what each life needs. So in the name of Jesus, we pray that You would be meeting every need according to Your riches and glory through Christ Jesus, as it says in Your word. Lord, we thank You for those this morning that are going to be coming up in a few minutes to be baptized. And Lord, I thank You for the work You're doing in each of their lives. And Father God, You are Lord of all. Your light shines in the darkest of places. So Jesus, would Your light shine forth in our lives and in our hearts. May we take what we have, God. May we not keep it that light under a barrel, but Lord, may we go forth from here. And may we show to the world Your love and Your praise through our changed lives. Thank You, Lord, for all You're doing. We love You. We just want to say that this morning, Lord. We love You, and our hearts are overflowing. In the strong name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, we pray. Now let's sing that chorus again as we do so in prayer.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that You're my God, You're altogether. Thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit and for your presence among us, O Lord. We pray that you'll just please, Lord, I pray that you help me just simply to pay attention, Lord, this morning to hear your voice. Throughout the week, Lord, to see and hear what you're doing, Lord, in those around me, to just be paying attention, Lord, to what you're calling me to do in the days to come. We thank you for this time. Bless Pastor. Lord, bless the breaking of your word. God, we thank you so much for your word, and we pray, Lord, that it will penetrate us, that you'll take your hand and write freely upon our hearts, oh God. Let us have ears to hear, Lord, that faith might be found in us, Lord, through the hearing of your word. We thank you so much for Pam and Dale. We pray, Lord, that you'll give them safe travels. This is a long way to go. We pray that you'll be with them, that you'll make appointments for them all along the way, that you'll bless them richly, Lord. Please, God, may love abound in us. May it abound in the church more and more. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Thank you, Bruce. All right. Thank you, worship team, for leading us.
Welcome.
Well, I don't know about you, but I kind of feel the presence of God here a little bit. What about you? Yeah? Okay, good, good. I'm glad I'm not the only one. You know, that's awesome. That's wonderful. Hey, our worship team exits the stage there, I want to thank them so much for all of our worship teams that, you know, we actually have like three or four different worship teams composed of different people, and it's wonderful to have such a variety of talent in our church, and just a wonderful thing that God is doing among us. So thank you to everybody who helps us lead in worship every week, all right? Well, let's see. It's kids time. I'm excited. Kids, come on up. I know we got some kids out here. Come on up, Jesse. Lead the way, my man. All right. That's right. Man, that's the best. Come on up, buddy. Come on up, Sam. There you go. All right. We got more. Come on up, Charlie. Come on up, Temperance. There you go. All right. Ooh, yeah, just find a spot. There you go. There you go. Here. Well, wait a minute. Okay, hang on. Wait. I'm confused. Which way am I going here? Okay, I'm going this way. All right. You guys scoot that way. I can't turn that far. I'm old. Come on. There you go. Move around it. There you go, Charlie. Thank you. All right, that's better. Well, a bunch of you are. Yeah, you are. Hey, everybody's up on the screen too, by the way, so you can see yourselves up there if you want, you know, so everybody can watch it. All right. Hey, I got something here this morning. Hey, does anybody wear one of these?
No.
No? You don't? No. No, this is like a, what is this? This is like a newborn diaper, right? All right. Yeah. You got to be like really, really little to wear one. I wouldn't fit. All right. And I don't think any of you would fit either. Well, what's this thing? Anybody know what this is? The baby toy. You know specifically what it might be, Jesse? You hold it in your hand, you rattle it. Okay. It's got a rattle. All right. And I think, and there's a teething ring too on there. I think you can like. And it goes back and forth like that. All right. Does anybody play with a toy like this?
No.
You don't? Why not, Jesse? You're all too big for it? Well, okay. I guess. I don't know. I think he's kind of a cute puppy dog. But okay, fine. Well, of course, now, you guys have all grown up, right? And you probably used to have toys like this. And you used to wear diapers this small and all of that. Okay. Honestly, we all did. I probably did, too, at one time. You imagine that? No, don't even imagine that. All right. Okay. Yeah. But now you've grown up a little bit, right? And you don't wear this stuff. And you don't play with these kinds of toys anymore. You play with bigger kid toys, right? All right. And I'll tell you, Legos. There you go. I'll tell you a secret, all right, that Pastor Dale still plays with toys too, although they're bigger toys. You know, I got like
a big giant bear.
Sure. Okay. All right. Uh-huh. What do you build? Oh, a Harry Potter owl. Oh, that would be awesome. That'd be awesome. Yeah, that's great. Yeah, I love Legos. Legos are fun to play with and to build stuff. All right. You're right, there is. Okay, well, here's the point, okay? All right, before we get too off track here this morning, all right? Yeah, here's the point. We all grow up, okay? But did you know that Jesus said that in order to get to heaven, we have to become like little children? He said that. Yeah, that's in the Bible. He said that. Does that mean we all have to wear diapers and play with rattles? No, of course not, okay? No. Yeah. Well, yeah, and you know, little baby has to depend on their mom and dad, right, for everything, for feeding and diaper changes and all this other kind of stuff, right, okay? Well, you know what? We're supposed to depend on God, too, no matter how old we get. You know, I depend on God more than I ever have in my life, and it's amazing. And when I come to God and say, Jesus, I can't do this. I depend on you to help me with my life, and he does that. And instead of coming to him like, hey, God, I can handle anything you throw my way, all right, we come to Jesus and say, oh, God, I really can't handle things. I'm just like a little baby sometimes. I need to depend on you, okay? And when we do that, God is really pleased with that, and he loves that, and he wants us to come to him like little children, not wearing diapers or playing with rattles, okay, but depending on him for our very lives and talking to him. And loving him and him loving us. So, all right, that's good. Let's have a word of prayer, okay? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, so much for this time. Thank you, God, that we can come to you as little children. And, Lord, I just pray that each of us would be doing that in the way that you call us to. Thank you for these kids. I pray that you would bless them as they grow in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, guys, you can go back to your seats. I'll be calling up some of you to get baptized afterwards, okay? So, there you go. All right. Good job. All right. Are you clapping for me or them? Them. Okay, that's what I figured. All right, that's good. All right. Well, God is at work. I tell you what, why don't you take a little break, and why don't you stand together, give somebody a hug or a handshake, let them know you are glad they are here this morning, and in a moment we will get started with looking into the Word of God. All right, you can make your way back to your seats. All right, thank you all so much. Well, the past couple of weeks, we've been talking about road tunes, and I've been sharing with you some of the songs that I really like and that I use in my playlist when I'm out on the road and everything. And with Pam and I flying to Florida this week, my playlist is going to get used a lot. So, but this is a song that every time it comes on, well, you know, you got to just really get into this song. And I'm not going to teach you all of the moves to this song, okay? But this is a song you can, like, exercise to because there's so many moves to it, all right? But I do want to teach you one, all right? And that is when we get to the part that says safe to shore, all right, you got to swim, all right? So you got to go like this. There you go. That's right. Ken's got it. Ken's got it, okay? All right, so when we get to that part, that's what you got to do, okay? The word should be up on the screen, all right? And I think you probably know this song.
in my wrestling, in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. Okay, that's the part right there, okay? Here we go. I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. There you go. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. I won't fear what tomorrow brings. With each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore.
Now this time, on this chorus, I don't want to be the only one up here with my arms moving, besides the safe to shore part, right? So you got to clap a little bit, all right? You guys ready? Here we go.
My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you home. My lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore.
Amen. There you go. I knew you guys could get into that.
Whew. All right. All right, now, should have gotten a little exercise there. Get those arms moving. Whew, I got some exercise. I'm sweating now. Whew, somebody turn the air conditioning back up. All right. Whew. Well, there's an old urban legend that maybe you have heard. It's about an encounter that takes place many years ago between an American naval vessel and some Canadians. All right. Now, in the dead of night, the American vessel is out on the sea, and it spots a light off in the distance. Well, it figured that it was another ship, and so the Americans signal this mysterious light. And the exchange goes like this. The Americans signal, please divert your course 15 degrees to the north to avoid a collision. The Canadians responded back, recommend you divert your course 15 degrees to the south to avoid a collision. The Americans said, this is the captain of a United States naval ship. I say again, divert your course. Canadians respond, no. I say again, divert your course. The Americans respond, This is the aircraft carrier USS Lincoln, the second largest ship in the United States Atlantic Fleet. We are accompanied by three destroyers, three cruisers, and numerous support vessels. I demand that you change your course 15 degrees north. That's 15 degrees north, or countermeasures will be undertaken to ensure the safety of this ship. The Canadians responded back, "We have our dog, our food, two beers, and a canary that's currently asleep. Also, we are a lighthouse. Your call." Surprised you guys haven't heard that before. It's been around for a long time. All right. Today we're going to take a look at what it means that Jesus is our lighthouse in a dark world. Now, there are many things that I really appreciate about God, but pretty much at the top of the list would be this one. That like a lighthouse, God is unmovable. Psalm 62, 1 through 8 says, "Truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Truly he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. How long will you assault me? Would all of you throw me down, this leaning wall, this tottering fence? Surely they intend to topple me from my lofty place. They take delight in lies. With their mouths they bless, but in their hearts they curse. Yes, my soul," the psalmist says, "find rest in God. My hope comes from him. Truly, he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock and my refuge. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge." Now, do you see all the words in there? Fortress, refuge, strength, rock. All of those words evoke pictures in our minds of a God who is strong and unshakable and unmovable. But that almost begs the question, what if God wasn't any of that? What if our God was like the gods of the other peoples in biblical times, or in our time, for that matter? Now, if you go back into the Old Testament, there are references to a couple of deities that the nations around Israel worshipped at the time. And God's people, the chosen people, the Hebrews, were told to stay away from those worthless gods, those worthless idols. And there were two that are mentioned most often in the Bible, all right? And their names are Baal and Asherah. Baal and Asherah. Now, Baal was a Canaanite god. That's him on the left over there, black and white, all right? He was a Canaanite god, and he was most often associated with fertility and rain. Now, in the land of Canaan, which became what we know as modern-day Israel, agriculture was a staple of life, right? A lot like it is around here. If it didn't rain, your crops wouldn't come in, and you might be left to starve or be begging on the street. So appeasing Baal and giving him offerings was, they hoped, the way to make sure their crops would be good. That doesn't sound too awful, right? Until you realize something. That child sacrifice, which involved burning the firstborn child of the year in the village, as well as temple prostitution, were routine parts of Baal worship. It's what they did. Well, now you can begin to understand why God commanded the Israelites to never engage in Baal worship, and why Baal was a terrible god to give your allegiance to. It's interesting to note, too, that Baal worship also involved eating and sacrificing pigs, and that may be one of the reasons why God forbade his chosen people to eat pork at the time, so as to help them keep separate from the pagan practices around them. All right? Makes sense, right? Well, the Canaanites had a whole slew of gods, like other peoples around them, that they could turn to and appease to make their lives easier. But there was one, even over Baal, that seemed to be most popular, and that was the female god named Asherah. Asherah was also a fertility goddess, and she was Baal's mistress, okay? Her symbol was usually a tall tree, and if you go back in the Old Testament and you read in there, you're going to find at times references to, about 30 references in the Old Testament to what were known as Asherah poles, all right? And these were usually big wooden poles carved into phallic shapes sometimes, and they would be set up on the tops of hills or at sacred sites throughout the land. And in the days before Israel would go into exile because of their worship of false gods, they even set up Asherah poles next to altars devoted to the real God. All right? And that was in direct violation of the scriptures. So they had gone way far away. Ritual sex was practiced next to these poles as a way to honor Asherah and Baal. So when God brought the Israelites into their promised land, his command to them was to wipe out the worship of these gods and to have nothing to do with them. But unfortunately, Israel didn't listen too well. And, you know, before we get too much down in Israel and say, why didn't you listen to God? Well, you know, we don't listen to God sometimes either, all right? But they didn't listen real well. And instead of getting rid of Baal and Asherah, they tried to compromise and serve both Baal, Asherah, and Yahweh, the God of Israel. But of course, that never works when you compromise your faith. And it would spell disaster for Israel in many ways. Now, Baal and Asherah and all the other idols of the time, they were fickle. They couldn't be trusted. But the God of Israel stood as a rock and a fortress for his people. And that same God who brought the Hebrews out of slavery in Egypt, who guided them through 40 years of wilderness wandering, through a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day, he drove out armies before them that vastly outnumbered them. He settled them in a fertile green land that was to be theirs and their children's forever. Well, that's the same God that we serve. He's the same God yesterday, today, and forever. And he is the one we can trust with our entire lives. And he alone is worthy of our praise. Now, I got a question for you this morning. Anybody here, have you ever fell for a scam? Ever fell for a scam? Some of you are brave enough to raise your hands, all right? Probably most of us have at some point or another. Now, a scam is when somebody promises you something and then doesn't deliver and it ends up costing you money or something else. Did you know that there were over 2.4 million reports of scams last year? 2.4 million. And they cost people a total of around $8.8 billion. So before you get down on yourself for falling for scams, there's plenty of other people that have too as well. For example, imposter scams, they enacted a high toll on their victims. They reported $2.6 billion in losses last year. That was an average loss, by the way, of $995 per person. Now, those kind of scams take on many different forms, but essentially they involve a criminal posing as someone you trust in order to steal your money. And so they often pretend to be a representative from a government agency who's contacting you regarding maybe Social Security, all right? That's a huge scam out there, or Medicare, or your taxes, or maybe they're a long-lost family member, right? And they know just enough details about you and your family to make it seem plausible, okay? Or maybe they're posing as some celebrity or a debt collector or even a utility company representative. Now, as far as I know, I've only been scammed once by a pro anyway. And this was a guy who posed as someone needing my help back years ago when I was a young single pastor. And this guy persuaded me that he would know that I was a real Christian if I gave him my money, all of it, which he would then give back a half hour later when he met me at a certain place. And that's how he knew that Christians were real and that he could trust me. And he told me, I'll receive Jesus if you just do this for me. All right. Now, I was 20-something, okay? And I was young and stupid and naive and all that kind of stuff. And and he was really good, by the way, with his spiel. I just have to say that because he probably wasn't, but I fell for it anyway. And so if I gave him money, you know, then he would give it back, you know, a half hour later, and everything would be good. He would come to church. That was the other thing, too. He said, I'll come to your church. I'll receive Jesus. I'll show up at your church next Sunday. And, man, as a young single youth pastor at the time, I wanted to impress my senior pastor. And so I thought, man, if I can get this guy to come to church, what an amazing story that's going to be. And it's going to be wonderful and awesome and all that kind of stuff. And, of course, it was not. I ended up forking over about 3 months' worth of my income at the time. And drained my bank account. I think I kept $100 in there just to keep the account open. You know, but all the rest I took out. Gave it to him, and he said, I'll be back in 30 minutes, and we'll meet at this place in 30 minutes. I said, cool, that's fine. I was there. 30 minutes later, he was not. Never showed up. And after kicking myself for being an idiot, I called the cops. Now, it made me feel a little better to find out later that I was not the only pastor he had swindled. In fact, he had been doing this across the country. And it was actually pretty cool because about a week or so later, the FBI showed up at my door. and these guys in suits, and they had all these picture books, and I got to pick this guy out. They had a picture of him in there, and I got to pick him out of the book, you know? And so that when I'm thinking, man, I get to be with the FBI. This is cool, you know? And I just knew, man, this guy's I'm going to get my money back, you know? Well, the guy did eventually get caught, all right? But I never got my money back, of course. I learned a hard lesson from that experience. And while others have sometimes taken advantage of my generosity since then, because honestly, I refuse to stop being a giving person just because I got burned one time, you know, but I've never been scammed in that way again. And I don't think I ever will be. At least I hope not. Now, here's the thing. Now, I tell you a story for a reason, because there are those who will tell you that God is just a scam, that he's a figment of imagination dreamed up to prey on the weak and the gullible. In fact, you probably remember the famous quote by Karl Marx. He called religion the opiate of the masses because he believed that there was no God, and anybody who said there was just trying to get something from you. There's an article I found online as I was doing research for this sermon, and it lists the five best reasons not to believe in God. Five best reasons not to believe in God. I'm going to give those to you this morning, all right? These are the five that the author gives as reasons not to believe. Number one, there's no evidence that God exists. Well, yeah, I mean, we don't see God, right, with our eyes yet. There will be a day when we will, okay? But we don't right now. But here's the thing. I can look out this window, and I can see plenty of evidence for the existence of God in his creation around. The Bible says that the creation speaks, shouts about God. And if you take the time to look, you will see that. I can look around this room, and I can see the evidence of God in each of you. For all of you living, breathing souls are put together in ways and through means that science cannot explain nor duplicate. Has science ever been able to create life? No, it cannot. And I don't think it's ever going to be able to, because life belongs with God. Second reason, he said, that it's illogical to believe. It's illogical to believe. Well, is it? Isn't it more illogical to believe that everything around us came into being by pure chance? I mean, really, honestly, if you take a look at that, if you take a look at what someone might say who doesn't believe in God, they would say, well, all of this, everything around you, the entire cosmos, the entire universe came into being simply by random chance over the course of billions of years. I'm sorry, that's illogical. It just is. And by the way, honestly, I'm pretty happy that God isn't logical anyway. Because if he was, then saving me by sending his own son to die on a cross for my sin would never have happened. And you and me would be stuck on the road to hell. That's just the way it is. So I'm pretty happy that God's not logical, really, you know. Third reason he gave to not believe in God was because of the existence or the preponderance of suffering, he calls it. In other words, if God was good, he would not have created the kind of world we live in to where so many bad things occur and where there's so much pain and suffering. But here's what the author fails to remember. And every time I run into this argument, there's this one thing that everybody seems to fail to remember. God did not create this kind of world. We did. It was our sin that has brought the world to where it is. You know, the reason the war is going on in Ukraine is because of sin. The reason that there is abuse and suffering in the world is because of sin, our sin. See, the Bible talks about it a lot. It was our sin that has brought the world to where it is. And honestly, without the hand of God intervening in many ways to keep evil in check somewhat, we would all be in far worse shape than we are. Can you imagine if God just said, oh, I'm done, you guys are on your own. Bye-bye, have fun. Can you imagine what evil man could come up with? We've already come up with so much anyway. Imagine how much worse it would be if the Holy Spirit did not keep things in somewhat of a check. And there will be a day when the Holy Spirit's going to be taken away, but that's a whole other sermon for another time. Fourth reason the guy gave was, we don't need him. Nobody needs God. Oh, really? Last time I checked, if I tried to get along without God in my life, I'd screw it up really bad. And trust me, I tried that for a lot of years, and I did screw things up really bad. And now, if I did turn my back on God, Well, I'd be separating myself from the one who can give me eternal life. So no thanks, man. I do need God, and I'm proud of that. And you ought to be as well. We do need him. That's why I told the kids up here, you know, we got to depend on him. We got to come as little children to him. Fifth reason the guy gave, I love this one. And he just said this is it. Life's better without God. Life's better without him. What? How could it be better? How can life be better without knowing the one who gives indescribable life, light, joy, peace, goodness, mercy, grace, and forgiveness to me and to you? What could be better than that? What could be better than having my sins washed away, my mind and soul set free, and my eternity guaranteed? Think about that. That's what God does for you. Life is not better without him. It's much better with him. Honestly, if you think life's better without Jesus, I hate to say this, you're just being kind of dumb. I mean, you just are. Because look at it. Look at all the things he gives. There's no way that you could say, well, my life would be better if I didn't have forgiveness in it. My life would be better if I didn't have peace. My life would be better if I didn't have goodness. Of course not. Of course not. God is not a scam. God is real. In fact, he's the only thing that is really real and lasting at all. Your money is not going to last. Trust me, I know, and so do you. Your good looks, they're not going to last. Trust me, I know, and so do you. Your house, your car, your bank account, your investments, your business, your possessions, none of it is going to last. Now you have a choice. You can build your life on the sandy foundation of this world and all that stuff, or you can build your life on the rock-solid reality of God. There was a parable that Jesus gave one time when he was here on earth. It's found in Matthew 7, 24 through 27. And here's how he put it. He said, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." And by the way, if you've been watching the news and you've seen what's been happening with the rains, you know, especially back east and all the devastation, and even in California from rains, and it's just amazing. You know, people will build their houses on the sides of hills that just get washed away. Sometimes we do that with our own lives, too, as well. Anybody here ever build a doghouse? Anybody ever build a doghouse? Dave, you build? Travis, you build a doghouse? Good, good, good. I'm just curious, Dave, how much of a foundation did you put under that doghouse? Not much? All right. Travis, did you put a deep foundation in that doghouse? Well, why not? Don't you like your puppy? Got a concrete slab and insulated box. All good for you. That's cool. All right. I've never built a doghouse, but Pam and I just bought a house, all right? And the foundation of our house, not our doghouse, our real house, all right, is about roughly 10 feet deep or so. It's enough to give a good basement, all right? Now, if you go over to Shanghai, China, though, you're going to see the world's third tallest building. It's called the Shanghai Tower. There's a picture of it. This building rises 2,073 feet in the air, and it has the deepest foundation of any building in the world because of its proximity to earthquakes and floods, all right? The foundation of the Shanghai Tower is 282 feet deep. I figured it out. I'm about 6 foot tall. You would have to stack me 47 times to get to the depth of the foundation of the Shanghai Tower. That's 47 me's. Don't even think about how bad that would be, all right? Is the foundation of your life that deep? Have you drilled down into the bedrock that is our God, who is unmovable and unshakable? If not, I got to tell you, when the storms of life come, and they will come, if you haven't experienced it already, you're going to be in danger of being swept away. So that's one of the things that I love about our God, is he's unmovable and unshakable. But to close today, I want to return a little bit to the whole lighthouse analogy. Now, there's one thing that a lighthouse does well, you know, It's got a rock solid foundation. It's not going anywhere. It's unmovable. It's unshakable. But there's one thing that it does really well. It shines in the darkness, right? In fact, that's a lighthouse's sole purpose. Now, I'm going to ask you a strange question for this time of year. Why do we celebrate Christmas in December? Never ask yourself that. Why do we? Jesus was not born on December 25th. Okay? Contrary, I'm sorry to burst your bubble if you've like gone to church all your life and just now hear that Jesus was not born in December. He was not, okay? More than likely, Jesus was born in the spring or probably early summer. We're not quite sure. But you get clues in the scripture about that. But he was definitely not born on December 25th. So why do we celebrate Christmas then? Well, see, back sometime in the 5th century when the church decided to settle on a day to celebrate Christ's birth, they chose December 25th. And part of the reason they chose that time of the year was because the nights, at least in the northern hemisphere, are at their very longest and coldest. Right? See, when the world is dark and when everything in it is nearly frozen and dead, maybe they chose that day because it was then that the words from Isaiah the prophet make their most sense. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. So when Christmas comes around and you go, why is it so dark? It's not. See, Jesus is the light of the world. And he is our lighthouse. When the world seems darkest to us, when we are troubled by bad news, or we see the results of man's inhumanity, or when we're lonely and afraid, or when we do not feel even like going on anymore, there he is, our lighthouse, shining in our darkness. And just as sailing ships of old knew that when they saw the lighthouse, they were close to home, so do we, as we continue to look at Jesus, know that he is bringing us home, safe to shore. Safe to shore. I'm going to ask those of you who are going to be baptized this morning, if you need to get ready, you need to go use the restroom to change or whatever, then this would be a great time to do that. Take a couple of minutes to do that as we wrap things up, and we'll begin the baptism in a few minutes here. But I want to challenge us all that whatever you may face this week, I want you to look up. I want you to look up. No matter what comes your way, no matter what bad news you get, no matter what the circumstances of your life happen, no matter what tragedies you may see on the news, no matter how dark the world is, I want you to look up because the lighthouse, Jesus Christ our Lord, is still shining. And here's what will happen when we look to him. Here's what will happen when we keep the lighthouse in view. Because what does a lighthouse do except guide the ships home, right? No. Isn't that what he will do for us as well? As we keep looking to him. And I know it's hard, ladies and gentlemen. I get it. I know that we're faced with all sorts of temptations. I know that it's so easy to just like forget about God or whatever. I know all that. I get that. I struggle with those same things, even as a pastor. But I got to tell you, if we keep our eyes set on Jesus, that lighthouse, he will lead us home. And when he does, all those arguments, you know, that the atheists gave, you know, I mean, we laugh at it now. I think we're really going to laugh at it then when we're standing in front of Jesus and the light fills our lives. And we will know that, yeah, everything is better with him. That, yeah, he does exist. He is real. He's not a scam. He is reality. He is our lighthouse. Let's close with a word of prayer here. Our Heavenly Father and our God, we thank you, Lord, so much that you are here with us. Thank you that you are the unmovable, unshakable rock. You are that lighthouse set on that rock that just guides us home. Lord, I pray for anyone this morning within the sound of my voice, whether here or online, Father, that's watching, I pray if they have not made that decision to receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior, that they would do that. No pressure, no guilt, just a knowledge that you are real, Father. And just a knowledge that we need to turn our lives over to you. You are the source of love. You are the source of life. You are the source of light. And God, we want to be surrounded by all of that. So would you bring more joy, more peace, more goodness, more mercy, more forgiveness into our lives? Thank you so much for being that lighthouse that will lead us home, safe to shore. We love you. All praise, all honor, all glory, all power be yours, both now and forever. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's children said, amen. Amen. Well, in just a couple of minutes, we're gonna begin with some baptisms here. And I want to take a moment to just let you know about that. Trying to get myself together here a little bit. Often there's questions sometimes about what baptism is. And so as when we baptize people, I always like to let everybody know what we're doing and why. All right? And so I just want to read these words to you to help you get a little more in line with it, understand a little bit better all about baptism. What is baptism? Well, see, in biblical times, baptism meant to be closely identified with and indistinguishable from something. So the word baptized in the Old Testament or in the New Testament times was used often when referring to dyeing clothes to change their color. The garment would be dipped in the dye, and it would become an entirely new color when they brought it out, and it was said to have been baptized. All right? So that's the origin of the word. Now, when a person becomes baptized into Christ, they are testifying to the fact that they are new creations in him. It says in 1 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. So this act of baptism is a witness to the world and to the church that those who are receiving baptism have received Jesus into their life, that their sins have been forgiven by his blood, and that they now seek to love God with their whole heart and mind and strength, and that they will endeavor to live in obedience to his commands. Now, in the Free Methodist Church, we typically practice baptism by immersion. The reason for that is the symbolic act of putting to death the old sin nature, having their sins washed away, and then rising to new life in Christ. Baptism does not save a person. Let's get that right. And does not automatically guarantee that they will go to heaven. That work of salvation was done in their heart when they received Jesus. By being baptized, they are giving testimony to that salvation they already have in Christ. And as a church, we are also pledging to do everything in our power to help them in that new life which they have received. That's important. We got to pray for them. We got to teach them. We got to love on them. We got to be there for them as they journey along the same path that we are all on together. That's what baptism is. I'm going to ask our baptizees if they're ready to come on up and just kind of line up here on this side of the stage. Okay? If you're ready, come on up. Let's come around over here, guys. Come around that way. It is not cold, Jesse. Well, at least I don't think it is. We'll find out, all right? Okay? Here we go, guys. Here. That's back. There you go. There we go. Okay. All right. Now, I'm gonna switch up the order of you guys, all right? Is that okay? We're going to let the big people go first. Is that all right? All right. So we're going to let... Now... I want to do just a couple quick introductions because you guys don't know this family yet, all right? But this is Chris Olinger and his brand new wife, Symmetry. I just married them yesterday, all right? All right? God has been doing an incredible work in their lives, all right? And some of their kids are here as well to get baptized. And there's Charlie right there. Charlie, wave your hand. All right, that's Charlie. And that's and that's Samuel behind him, all right? And then we got Temperance over there. Wave your hand there, Temperance. There you are, okay? All right. And I am excited to have them here and to get to the pleasure and privilege of baptizing them in the Lord. And I'm so grateful for what God has done in your life and is doing. And it's an amazing story. One of these days, you'll have to talk to them about it. God's just doing a great work in their lives, all right? So, who wants to be first? Chris, you want to go first? All right. Come on in. Just kind of step in there. You can take your sandals off if you want. Yeah, there you go. All right. All right. Step in. I'm going to have you step kind of over here. There you go. There you go. All right. All right. Now, the easiest way to do this is if you sit down, because I can't get you all the way down there and back up. All right. All right. Sit down. Scooch forward a little bit for me there. There you go. This is good practice for you guys, so you'll see what's going on here. All right. All right. All right. Guinea pig. Yeah. Yeah. There we go. Yeah. Don't you feel special now? Yeah. All right. Okay. All right. After you get out of here, Pam will have a towel for you over there too as well, so you don't have to drip dry on the carpet. All right. All right. All right. Oh, yeah. Let me take this off here because I don't want to get that wet. All right. All right. Hang on. We're gonna wait for somebody to get a seat there so she can see. There we go. That's fantastic. We got Chris's mom is here and Symmetry's mom is here too as well. All right. So fantastic. All right. All right. Chris Olinger, it is my pleasure and privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. All right. All right. That's it. Good job. Yeah. Praise God. Welcome to the family. All right. All right. Help you out there. There we go. Yeah. All right. We got plenty of tarps and towels. It's all okay. All right. It is actually very warm. It's nice. Yeah, yeah. It's nice. It's warmer than the last time I did it. It's okay, Jesse. Just sit back. You're going to get in. Don't worry about it, kid. Man. There you go. Come on in. See, it's nice and warm, right?
It is.
Yeah,
it's
okay. Warm. Yeah, it's bathtub warm. Yeah, that's. You're lucky. Just sometimes it's not. So, all right. All right. Symmetry Olinger, it is my pleasure and privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. All right. Put you up there. All right. Fantastic. All right. You guys can stay up here and watch your kids. That's no problem. Oh, you okay? Oh, you got anything in your pockets? Check them in. Oh, yeah. Take that out. There we go. Anything else? We're good. All right. Okay, buddy. There you go. Oh, wow. You're almost, he like disappears there. It's okay. I got you, man. All right. Samuel Olinger, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. All right. Good job, buddy. Good job. Did good. Oh, that's hard. There we go. Get him out. All right, who's next? Charlie, you're next. All right. Nice and warm, see? Yeah. All right. Oh, you got it. There you go. Just get comfy. Doesn't matter. Whichever way. As long as you can lay back, we're good. All right. You can plug your nose if you want to. It's okay. Yeah. All right. Charles Olinger, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. There you go. Good job, man. Good job. All right. There we go. Yep. Stay on the tarp, sir. There you go. All right. You like that? Yeah. I told the family when I was talking to them this week that I used to baptize kids in a cold tub, mountain-fed stream. It was about 35 degrees, and so this is a lot better than that. So, all right, you ready? Yeah, all right. Temperance Olinger, it is my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Okay. Hold your breath. There you go. There you go. Good job. All right, yeah. All right. All right. Jameson, you're next, my man. All right, come on. Let's do this. Whew, yeah. All right. Oh, yeah, it's a lot more than we thought it would be. Yeah. All right. Now, I want to tell you something about Jameson. I just want to brag on these two a little bit, okay? All right, because I've known them for as long as we've been here. What's that? I can't brag on you? I'm gonna brag on you a little bit, man. All right. 5 months? No, it's longer than that. I've been here over a year, man. It's okay. Yeah. So Okay. So Jameson is the kind of young man that will do anything for you at any time. He has really got a heart of service to the Lord. And I'm very proud of you. Okay? I'm very proud of you. I'm very proud of the young man that you are becoming. All right? So I'm so glad that you're taking this step. All right? You ready? Yeah. All right. You going to hold your nose or you good?
I can blow bubbles.
You can blow bubbles. Of course you can. All right. Take back everything I said. No, not at all. All right. Jameson Lawson, it is my pleasure and privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. There you go. That's my man. Good job, man. Yeah, there. Okay, there we go. All right. All right, Jesse, come on in, dude. Yeah, surprisingly warm. I told you it was, man. All right, sit down there. There you go. All right, scooch forward a little bit for me. There you go. All right. Okay. All right. Now, I'm also going to brag on Jesse a little bit, too, all right, because I've been so impressed with both of these young men. And Jesse, what I have seen in you so much, kid, is your love for the Lord. And if you ever want to know how to worship God, all right, you look at Jesse when he's singing songs. He's got his hands raised. He is belting out those lyrics with his whole heart and voice, and it's amazing. You have impressed me so much, young man, and you're amazing. All right, so before I start crying, okay.
I'm
almost two. You almost two? All right.
I'm
all right, you gonna hold your nose, or are you good? You're good. All right, here we go. All right, Jesse Lawson, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Got it. Here, give me a hug. Oh, yeah. Oh, awesome. Oh, hang on. Let's get you out. There we go. And we're out. Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. Would you all join me? Would you stand together? Now, let's join in a word of prayer for these. And then, but stick around afterwards, because praise team is going to come up and they're going to close us in a song. And you got to get your hands together and really worship the Lord with that, all right? So here we go. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Jesus, thank you for these who have been baptized. I pray, Father, we all pray that you would anoint them with special grace as they journey in their life with you. Lord, I just pray as a church, we would surround them, we would love on them, we would minister to them, teach them, and God, that they would know you more and more each and every day. Thank you for these families. Thank you, God, for all you're doing in their lives. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's children said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. All
one,
right. Let's worship
two,
the Lord.
Three,
guys.
Four.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. Turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. Oh, the cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back. Go with me, still I will follow. Oh, though none go with me, still I will follow. No, none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning.
Once more, I have decided.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
Amen.
All right. week. Have a great life in the Lord. Celebrate. Pray for those who've been baptized. We'll see you all next week. Have a great week.
Thanks, everybody.